from this class. The intent of today is for you to stop and think about how one decision can ultimately change your life and the lives of the people around you. We will all face tough decisions in our lifetime. Our hope is that you will make your one decision the right one. Joseph Joe Anthony Davis, born March 7th, 1995, died April 4th, 2012. Joseph Anthony Davis.
Haven Turner of Schaefer was pronounced dead at the scene of an alcohol-related crash on April 4th, 2012. Haley was a senior at Chisago Lakes High School and was planning on attending the University of Minnesota Twin Cities to study physical therapy with a major in kinesiology. Haley loved music and was heavily involved in the school's choir and marching bands. She also participated in Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As you all know, my name is Officer Corey Spencer. I work with the Lakes Area Police Department. I've been a school resource officer for Chisago Lakes School District for 3 years now. My hopes are that next year that I will be in the high school working with the same group of students. Most of them, some of them seniors, will be graduating, but the juniors I will see next year as well. You've heard this statistic at least twice. Today will be the third time. Statistics have shown that every 15 minutes, someone will be killed in an alcohol-related car crash. Yesterday, you got a front row seat to an unpleasant experience that my colleagues in law enforcement, fire, and EMS all too often see. The intent of this program is to make you stop and think about how one decision may adversely affect your life and lives of people around you as well. The video that you're about to see will show you not only the events leading up to the crash, but also the ripple effect of events after the crash that will forever change the lives of those that are involved. Students, please take your seats.
Mike, where's the
booth? I think to Alexa's.
Really?
Yeah, there should be plenty of booze.
Really? I think we should probably call some people, get some people over there.
Yeah, definitely. Get some girls.
Is this thing on?
Word.
So what? We get drunk. So what? We don't sleep. We're just having fun. We don't care who sees. So what? We go out.
And then we get a lighter.
That's please. How it's supposed to be.
Keep them rolled up, sagging my pants, not caring what I show. Keep it real, if you don't know me, keep it playing with my bros. It look clean, don't it? Washed it the other day, watch how you lean on it. Keep me some 501 jeans on it. Roll up bigger than King Kong's fingers and burn them things down to they stingers. You a class clown, and if I skip for the day, I'm with your chick smoking gray.
You know what? It's like I'm 17 again, peach fuzz on my face. Looking on the case, trying to find a hella taste. Oh my God, I'm on the chase. Chevy, it's getting kinda heavy. Irrelevant selling it. Dipping away, time keeps slipping away. Zipping the safe, flipping for pay. Tipping like I'm dripping in paint. Up front, folk, like a leaf of quito in the J.
So what, we get drunk. So what, we don't sleep. We're just having fun. We don't care who sees. So what, we go out. That's how it's supposed to be. Living young and wild and free.
Care long as me and my team in here, it's gonna be some green in the air. Tell them Mac,
blowing everywhere we going, and now you know when I step right up, get my lighter so I can light up.
That's how it should be done. Soon as you're thinking you're down, find how to turn things around. Now things are looking up
from the ground up.
Better popcorn.
Let's get the first leg. Oh my god, I call mom.
MACDEVHD3.
It's me, this is us. We gon' fuss and we gon' fight and we gon' roll and live our life.
So up, we get drunk. So up, we don't sleep. We're just having fun. We don't care who sees. So up, we go out. That's how it's supposed to be.
Mikey, come on, pull yourself together, Mikey.
Smoke one, when you live like this, you're supposed to party. Roll one, smoke one, and we all just having fun. So we just roll one, smoke one, when you live like this, you're supposed to party. Roll one, smoke one, and we all just having fun.
So up, we get drunk. So up, we don't sleep. We're just having fun, and we don't care who sees.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you I wear this crown of thorns upon my liar's chair, full of broken thoughts I cannot repair. Beneath the stains of time, the feelings disappear. You are someone else. I am still right here. What have I become? My sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you hurt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I would keep
is blowing.
Is it getting better?
Blowing, you're gonna hear a tone. Keep going until that tone stops.
Or do you feel the same? Will it make it easier on you now? You got someone to blame. You're sad. Won't love. Won't life. When it's one need in the night. Won't love. We get to share it. Leaves you, baby.
There are several students and families that wish to share their letters. And first, I would like to invite Danny Kimlinger to the stage.
dear family and friends, today I died and never got the opportunity to tell you how much of an impact you've had on my life. Words will never be able to describe the amount of respect I have for you and your life-defining influence. But in the next few minutes, I will attempt to explain as much of it as I can. Over the last 5 months, much of my out-of-school time has been spent in front of the computer with the intent of completing college scholarships and applications. A small portion of that time that actually was spent completing these applications taught me a lot about myself. With each extracurricular activity and after-school support I filled in, I realized that my life has become defined by a large number of school and community involvement. It is through these activities and events that I have learned to make lasting friendships and get along with new people every day. I have learned to grow not only in my academic education, but also in my out-of-school life. I have been active through hours of school sports, music, and outdoor activities, and I have shared countless memories with my family and friends. As I then minimized my Word document window to log on to Facebook, search on YouTube, or talk to a family member in the room, I realized that they are the reason I am in this position today. I have been blessed with a close, loving family. I have the opportunity to attend a private, promising liberal arts college. I have a network of friends that I would not trade the world for. And all of the above have been placed in my life by powers beyond my control. The point is, although I do my best to maintain the fortunate lifestyle that I live, I cannot take credit for any of it. From the minute I entered kindergarten and moved to Chisago Lakes, I have made friendships that will last a lifetime. I would be up all night trying to count the number of loving, caring peers that are in my life, and I would have counted about half of them come sunrise. Thank you so much to all my fellow students who have been there for me for the last 13 years. It is your openness to friendship and welcoming personality that make those around you so much better. Thank you very much. Also, I would like to thank my parents and my siblings, my family. I'm luckier than Lou Gehrig to have David, Ellen, Joe, Katie, and Ron in my family. They are irreplaceable pieces to the puzzle of my life. Family dinners, camping on the river, spring break vacations, and sunny days on the lake have been without contest the most memorable activities of my life. I love you all. I know the phrase is used a lot, but I cannot imagine life without them. I owe them more than I could ever repay them. They have taught me how to communicate, how to cooperate, and have given me countless other life qualities that truly shaped who I am, and I cannot stress enough how grateful I am for everything they've given me. To conclude, I'm sorry to all of you. Friends and family members like you do not deserve to suffer from the decision that I've made, yet what has happened is irreversible. It is not a commitment I can break up. It is not an action that I or anyone else can retract. I have made a thoughtless, gutless, and most of all, selfish decision, and now those of you who have been there for me all along must pay the price. I believe that I speak for the entire group when I say if we only save one life, influence one positive, life-changing decision, then we have accomplished our task. Before you ever make that decision, that life-altering decision of whether or not to drive your own or ride with a drunk driver, do not think about your own personal consequences. Think of those around you who love you, and I trust you will make the right decision.
Next, we've got a speech by Junior Joel Davis.
Dear family and friends, today I died and never got the opportunity to tell you how much you inspired me. You inspired me in many ways through a number of experiences. You've challenged me, taught me, you've disciplined me, and you've praised me. You've shown me how to hunt and fish, you've demonstrated to me to be successful as a father, brother, friend, and most importantly, a human being. There's no possible way to express all the things you've contributed to my life. I have laughed with you, I have been sad with you. But the things that I remember most is the good times. Times that we shared in happiness. These are times that I cherished. You inspired me to play sports and try new things. If you had not done this, I might not have been a starter on the varsity football team as a sophomore. I may not have placed sixth at the Deca State Conference. If my family and friends had not inspired me, I might not have chose to attend St. Thomas after high school. I wouldn't have chose to pursue my passion of working in business. All of my influence were out of my power. I did not get to choose to have a supportive family who never missed a game. I was not allowed to choose to have a small group of guys who I had grown up with to watch my back while I watched theirs. But I was blessed with the right people around me to keep me from straying from my path, to guide me through the tough times in life. For this I thank you. I am eternally grateful that you have entered my life and immeasurably disappointed that I have left yours so early in our journey. My only hope is that I inspired you a fraction of the amount that you have inspired me. Your loving son, brother, and friend, Joe.
In addition to the letters written by students, we also have letters written by parents. And Mrs. Jillian Davis is going to share her letter to Joe with us today.
Joseph, today we were told you passed away in an accident. We will never get to tell you again how much you are loved. We are blessed with so many fun memories from the 17 short years you were with us. Your senior year was right around the corner. The endless hours spent talking about school and sports, whether it was a tackle on the field, an awesome play at home plate, shooting hoops or playing hockey at Turks, will be no more. There won't be any more refrigerator certificates from Victor Vector. The unfinished PS3 game will never be won. The hunting and fishing adventures will never happen. We will never get to plan your high school graduation party. There will not be a senior prom. We will never get to talk about Tommy Purple anymore, or finish touring other colleges. Your marketing and business career will forever be just a dream. We will never dance at your wedding. I will never get to hold your firstborn child. I didn't get to tell you how proud I was of your loyalty to us, to your brother, to your friends, and your Wildcat teammates. The fun days of Uncle Joe wrestling with Trevor are over. All he will ever know of you are the stories we tell and the photos we share. Since your accident last June, I was the constant nagger, reminding you and your buddies about driving safe. Wear your seatbelt, no talking on the phone, no texting, no reaching for water bottles, and no monkey business. My heart is broken. I can't help but wonder, if I would have said it to you one more time, would it have mattered? I thought you understood how lucky you were to come away from that accident with just a broken leg. A mother's need to protect her babies continues long after they walk and drive. Our faith has been a solid part of who we are. I will miss saying prayers together. I will continue to lean on my faith for strength. I believe you are in heaven with all the Sanchez and Davis angels. One day we will see each other again. You will always be remembered with love, mi hijo. If I could turn back the hands of time to the day you made the one decision, two things I would hope to change. First, the choice you made to party and get behind the wheel. And second, I wouldn't bug you so much about your hair. We love you.
Thank you, Mr. Davis. Next is a student letter by Katie Odette.
Dear family, today I died and I never got to tell you how much you mean to me. You helped form me into the girl I am today and I love you all for that. I don't know where I would be now if it was not for you. Mom, I'm sorry for disrespecting you and not valuing your opinions. I can't count the times you have forgiven me for my wrongdoings, and I always appreciated that. I always used to love when you would go out of town and you left me a note and a little baggie of jelly beans. I always wanted you to be proud of me, and even though I never showed it, it killed me inside. I only hoped in our future our bond could have strengthened. Christina, we fought, we yelled, and there were times that absolutely could not stand to be in the same room with you, but you now never get a chance to know how much I loved you, and even though you were younger, I looked up to you. I tried my hardest to be a good role model, and I know I didn't always do the best job. The dumb random texts we exchanged, and the times we say the same thing at the same time, and the mornings we would hide from each other because we wore each other's clothes without asking, always made me laugh. I admired your carefree attitude and the way you always drive yourself to success. If I were alive today, I could have only hoped you and me would have grown closer than we were before the crash. To my friends and peers, I want you always to remember that one day we died because of the one decision. Everything that went on was 100% preventable. Each day I walked the halls with you and sat in your classrooms, I never would have thought that one day, just like that, just like you could be gone due to one careless act.
Next we have Tony Randall. It's Nick Randall's father. Nicholas, you died today, and I never got to say how much I love you. I never got to thank you for the last 18 years. These are memories I will cherish the rest of my days. I never got to tell you how, on the day you were born, I was filled with the joy and love of knowing God had sent you to us. As your mom and I drove away from the hospital with you, I was white-knuckled with the knowledge of the importance of the gift we were carrying and wondering if we were up to the task. I never told you what the joy I felt getting on the bus your first day of school. I watched you climb the stairs and happily sit next to your cousin Brian, and as the bus drove away, I breathed a sigh of relief, knowing it would be all right. I never told you how sweet we thought it was you would occasionally cry in kindergarten. When we asked you why you were sad, you explained, sometimes when it's quiet in the classroom, you would think about us and start to miss being away from home. I never told you how much it meant for us to see you as an altar server at St. Peter's, especially at Gabby's First Communion. Your mom would tear up as you stood on the altar and many a mass was prayed in your honor as we watched you serve your church. I never told you how much I loved sharing your History Day experience with you. Through the long hours of creating, then recreating, then creating again, and again were arduous. I looked over your shoulder and swelled with the pride of a father who knows his family history will live on. I never told you how much I loved going to the Viking-Packer game at Lambeau with Brett Favre as a Viking, relaxing on Barefoot Beach in Florida as a family, going deer hunting at the farm with your cousins and uncles, taking a long trip out to Gettysburg with your grandfather, watching you open your acceptance and scholarship letters from colleges, hanging out, watching sports together. I never told you that when your mom and I lay in bed some nights, we reflect on how wonderful our kids are and just how lucky we are to have you as our son. It was never as much about the big accomplishments. Sure, those are nice, but it was the little things we cherish. I bet you didn't see the smile on your mom's face when you would give your little sister a hug. I bet you didn't know she was happy to have a few minutes with you in the afternoon making meatballs together. I bet you didn't know she really didn't need the help and just wanted you with her. I never told you that what I will miss the most is the next 18 years. I was looking forward to your graduation from high school, your graduation from college, watching you start your career, your wedding, your children, and my grandchildren. I wanted to be there when you succeeded and when you failed. These are the things I can only imagine now. I wish I could have been there for you when you needed me most. If only love were enough to save you, we would have protected you We would have told you not to take the car the day you did. We would have told you to leave a few minutes later. We would have told you it can wait. We would have told you. We were blessed to have you grace our lives for the 18 years you were here. In the words of Langston Hughes, I love my friend. He went away from me. There's nothing more to say. The poem ends. Soft as it began, I love my friend. Take care, my son, and God bless. Dad.
And now Nick Randall will share his letter.
Today I died and never had the chance to tell you how much more I miss you. In these 18 years of life, I've had a million experiences. Each one I'll remember and cherish. Do you remember spring break this year? It's a trip we've done multiple times, but this time it was different. It was one of those experiences where our family bonded and came closer together, especially with it being last year at home. I needed that feeling. Times like these helped shape me into the man that I was. Mom and Dad, you encouraged me to go wherever and do anything. You've been the motivation to all I've done. Thank you so much. I can't wait to see you sometime soon. I love you. Your son, Nick.
As I said before, it was a very difficult task to ask students and parents alike to write those letters. But as I was walking down the hallway of the hotel last night doing bed checks at 11 p.m., fully expecting them to be jumping up and down on their beds, having pillow fights, throwing food in their hotel rooms, when I walked past, I heard talking. And the talking that I heard was these letters that they were sharing with each other and helping each other write. Let's give them another round of applause. At this time, it is my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker, the Honorable Judge Rancourt.
Good morning. I would like all of those people who had anything to do with this event today to stand, please. Anybody else? Let's all acknowledge them. This is quite incredible. I would like to also thank those in the community that are not here today who have participated in this event, including the firemen, funeral directors, and others, giving their time on such an important issue. I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to address all of you this morning relating to the consequences of certain decisions you may make and the impact they have on your life. And I would like us to have a moment of silence to remember those who have died as a result of drunk drivers. Thank you. My first experience with drinking and the devastation of drinking, I was a high school student, a junior, and one of my closest friends, after a drinking episode at a party, was with a friend going around a curve at a very high rate of speed and hit a tree head on and ended up in a casket. I was a pallbearer at that particular funeral, and I'll never forget it to this day, many, many years later. That was my first experience. I subsequently, after graduating from high school, became a criminal defense lawyer. And during that time, for many years, the cases I was involved in, where people were killed, permanently disabled, or suffered, related to decisions they made about the use of alcohol and other drugs. When I became a judge, I observed the same pattern of devastation when people have decided to use alcohol and other drugs, including prescription drugs and marijuana. My purpose today is not to lecture you, but to convey to you the severe consequences when you decide to use alcohol and other drugs. I realize the great pressure many of you face daily to be part of a group or be popular in school, and sometimes that pressure may cloud your judgment. Many of our movies today, many of our commercials, really emulate, if you will, drinking and using drugs, but they never show the consequence of those decisions. How many movies do you actually see the ending where someone is in a funeral, or you've seen letters that these young people have written, or their parents have written today? You don't see that part of that commercial or that movie. So all you see is some type of a glorification of the use of drugs and alcohol. Trust me, there's no glorification. One thing that we are seeing a lot of today, not only in the state of Minnesota, but nationally, is the number of increased cases involving bullying in school as a result of social media such as Facebook. We have observed an increase in assault among young people, as well as depression, suicide, and violence nationally. Before any of you make a decision about whether to bully someone, ask yourself about how you would feel if you were the one who was being bullied, or it was outside the group, if you will, and if you could live with the consequence of someone hurting themselves or others because of your actions. I also see on a daily basis the results of decisions by young people who decide to use alcohol or drugs so they can be accepted as part of a group. The problem with the decision can best be seen by the mock crash enactment you have been involved in, and you have seen the movie today. You have also seen these wonderful students and their parents present heartfelt letters relating to what happens as a consequence of that type of behavior. I'll give you an example. What you've seen today is a reenactment. That reenactment is something that I see many times on a weekly, if not monthly, basis in our courtrooms in the state of Minnesota and nationally. You may be a student with a tremendous opportunity to go to a trade school, college, or serve in the military and live a great, productive life. It is now a Friday night, and you hear about a party at a friend's house or in a field, and you attend with the idea that parents have given you great advice. Stay away from drinking and driving, drinking at all, you're underage. So you go to that party with the idea that you will not consume alcohol or drugs. However, you arrive at that party, and due to peer pressure, you either consume alcohol, take other drugs, or both, which is your first bad decision. You then make the decision to drive home, either driving yourself or as a passenger, when you know the driver has been drinking. You know your parents have told you if you ever do drink to call them, but you won't do so. We never see that happen, very rarely. You're having a great time. You're listening to music in the car, not realizing that your judgment is impaired and your reactions have slowed. You do not realize that your car has drifted into another lane of traffic and you are going over a hill and you strike a car head on, causing serious injuries to your passengers and your friends and killing the mother of three children, ages 6, 8, and 10, who was coming home from working a late shift to support her children. You are charged with criminal vehicular homicide You're 18 years of age. You are an adult in Minnesota for the purposes of punishment. You are arrested and either plea or verdict or convicted and appear at a sentencing. What you've seen today with some of these students reading letters, some of these parents reading letters, is what we see at sentences. Those are real events. Those aren't recreated events. Those are real events. And many times you'll have a courtroom full of people like this. On the one side, you'll have the defendant's family of an 18-year-old girl or boy who, because of a poor decision, is facing 4 years in prison. On this side, you have the family of the deceased individual who are presenting letters, such as we've heard today, who are presenting video of that dead person's life. Minor children who want to address the court about their mother or father who are now dead and want some type of retribution, knowing that they'll never have that family member back in their lives again. That is real. That's what we see. That is real. Those sentences sometimes take 2 to 3 hours and are extremely emotional. The day of sentencing comes, and the family of the mother who was killed is there, as well as your family. The first person to speak is the sister of the mother who you killed in the crash. And she relates how the children's father died a year earlier from cancer. And the mother had to work 2 jobs to support her children, who she looked forward to seeing graduate from school and get married and move on with their lives someday. And how now the children have no mother and no father. The sister ends her statement by saying she will never walk in the sun again. She'll have to learn to walk in the dark due to her grief. The court then hears from your family, who support you and say what a wonderful person you are, and that you made a terrible choice, and that you should not be sent to prison. However, based on the amount of alcohol and drugs in your system and the devastating impact of the accident, the court finds no basis to keep you out of prison and sentences you to 4 years in prison. Not in a week from now, not in a month from now, but now. So a bailiff handcuffs you, takes you into the holding cell, and transports you to one of our state facilities for 4 years. Now that's not the end of the story. Because the impact of what you've done has an impact on your family, friends, and relatives, as well as the deceased family's friends and relatives. You'll come out of prison. That person that was killed will not come back. And when you do come out of prison, your life will not be the same. You'll have a felony record, have a very difficult time trying to find employment for the rest of your life. But beyond that, you'll live with the guilt of having taken someone's life for the rest of your life. I've seen it, and that is real. Now, if you could and I tell many young people that come before me in court, to play it forward, if you will, that's the term I use. Because if you could rewind the story now that I've just given you and go back to the decision to go to the party, drink and drive, or be a passenger in a vehicle where someone may have been drinking, would you still make that decision? After seeing the events that occurred thereafter, I would think not. I would think not. So I ask all of you, when making a decision, play it forward. And think about the possible serious consequences that could result. Serious, serious consequences. Make good decisions. To quote a 16-year-old boy from Nevada, don't make your decisions on the advice or pressure of people who don't have to live with the consequences. Because many times in our sentences, when we see the family members of the victim and we see the family members of the defendant, we don't see those individuals who provided the alcohol that evening. They're not in the courtroom. They're not facing the consequence at all. They're not going to prison with you. Their life isn't going to be changed. Remember that. When someone is trying to pressure you to use alcohol or other drugs. I want all of you today to use the gifts you have all been given You are the future. There's no question about that. I'm always so impressed by young people in our community and nationwide. You have great gifts. There's no question about that. And I'm going to leave you with a quote from former Senator Robert Kennedy, who stated, "It's from the numberless diverse acts of courage and belief that human history is shaped. Each time a man or woman stands up for an ideal, acts to improve the lot of others, or strikes out against injustice, he or she sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And all of you, if you make the proper decisions, can be that individual to make positive decisions and set forth a tiny ripple of hope for all of those less fortunate. So use your gifts that you're given, use the great education that you receive, and all I can close is by saying to all of you, please think before you make decisions. Think of the consequences. Live a good and productive life. Use your energy for good things. Thank you very much."
Thank you, Judge Ranford. Before we attempt to get back to our regular scheduled classes, please welcome to the stage Mr. Ertl.
Wow, what a last 2 days for us. What will you do? We've seen how drinking and driving can affect your life, your family, your friends, our community, our school community. Many of us through this program have felt various emotions, and this is through a mock simulation. Those emotions are compounded to the nth degree in realities. So what will you do if and when you are in similar situations, and at some point many of you will, what will you do? We truly hope that you make good, healthy decisions and choices. A special thank you goes out to Lakes Area Police Officer Corey Spencer once again, who was instrumental in organizing and facilitating this program. SAD coordinators Mr. Piper and Mrs. Budding, they have poured many, many hours into organizing this program and working with student participants and their families. And the many other SAD students behind the scenes working on this special project. Also, our own Chisago Lakes High School Liaison Officer, Lakes Area Police Officer Brian Carlson. There were many other countless volunteer hours and resources that went into presenting this program to Chisago Lakes High School. Our community truly cares about our students and the health of our students. I'd like to thank the entire Lakes Area Police Department, the Chisago Lakes High School staff for their flexibility, Lindstrom, Chisago, Center City, and Schaefer Fire Departments who participated in the drill yesterday, our makeup artist, Mrs. Carlson, Farmers Insurance for their vehicle donations of yesterday, Grants Grand Funeral Home, Lakes Area EMS, our guest speaker today, the Honorable Judge Rancourt, and Chisago County Sheriff's Department. In closing, I'd like to thank again all the student participants and their parents and families for their efforts and dedication to this project. Again, I will ask that question. What will you do given the choice? The rest of the day's schedule will be as such. In just a moment, we're gonna have you go and have passing time back to first block. First and second block today will be abbreviated time schedule with passing times. We do have a bell schedule built. After second block, which will end typically when second block does, we will enter into a normal block 3 and block 4 schedule for the remainder of the day. But for the remainder of this morning, we will have abbreviated first and second blocks today. Once again, thank you and have a safe Easter holiday break. You're dismissed.